tonight. And before we do, let me just share a little of our testimony. Y'all, my wife Allegra's over there taking care of our little ones now. We have two of our kids here. This is Arrow and Saber. But we're from just south of St. Louis, Missouri. And just to share a very, very brief little moment of our testimony. About 8 years ago, God just started burdening us that we're in the last days right now. That we need to stop wasting time, amen, and live loud for our God. And about 8 years ago, my wife and I, after praying and fasting very, very seriously for several months, felt God impressing that on our spirits. So we stepped aside from our full-time jobs. And back then, I was a school administrator at a Christian school. My wife was a fifth-grade school teacher. And we left our jobs, and we just went out on the road and started sharing Jesus with everybody we could. And that's honestly our story. And so that's what we do. We minister at prisons all over the country. We minister at recovery groups, praise God. And praise, we minister at homeless outreaches, churches, anywhere God opens up a door. And so that's us and what we're doing. But tonight, I don't want to talk about me so much, but I want to talk about the power of God's Word. Amen?
Amen?
Amen. So if you have your Bibles with you, I want to encourage you to open them up to Luke chapter 11. Luke chapter 11, starting in verse 28, and I'm not going to share a lot of verses tonight. We're going to take a lot of time on them, though. We're going to go through about four different verses tonight, but Luke chapter 11, verse 28. Again, Luke chapter 11, verse 28 through 32. And as you're flipping over to that scripture, tonight what I want to talk about is things that are false, or at least things that appear to be false but aren't necessarily are. Let me give you an example of what I'm talking about. Has anyone ever been on Craigslist before and seen those advertisements where you see this like really, really cool motorcycle or this really cool truck, and it's like, you know, only like $200, and you know there's no possible way it could be true, but you click on it anyway? Anybody? Because you know there's going to be that one time when it is for real. That's a false statement that appears to be true. Well, believe it or not, Jesus said some things in the Bible that when he said them, even though they were true, they appeared to everybody else to be false. So he said things that were true, but sometimes people didn't believe it. They appeared to be false. And that's what I want to look at today is four different things in the scripture, in this group of scriptures here, four things that Jesus said that I imagine a lot of people heard him say it and they said, that can't be right. But yet it was very true. So that's what we're going to look at here in Luke chapter 11, verse 28. And again, four things that appeared to be false, and we're going to see four truths that God wants to speak to us. So let's pray, and let's just ask God to take over tonight. Father God, I thank you so much for what you're doing this evening. God, I thank you for your word, for how rich it is. And God, I pray that today this wouldn't be me speaking and my opinions and ideas, but it would be your word revealing truths to our heart that we need to hear. Help us not to be like the rest of the world where we just doubt you, God. Or we just think, that can't really be. But God, help us to be people that truly put our confidence and trust in what you say. And we just ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. So Luke chapter 11, verse 28. This first scripture is just kind of a kickoff scripture for us. But in Luke chapter 11, verse 28 says, he replied, blessed rather are those who hear the word of God and obey it. And I'm reading this scripture because this scripture really is the theme for everything we're going through. Blessed are those who hear the word of God and obey it. To give you the context of what's going on in this scripture we're going to read right here. This is happening at a point in Jesus' ministry where Jesus is crazy popular. He's what I like to call a rock star in Israel. What I mean by that is Jesus is literally having thousands of people show up anywhere he preaches. This is at the point where he's done several miracles. He's done several signs and wonders. And people have heard about Jesus and flocked to him. And I think he's probably in Jerusalem right now because of all the kind of people he's talking to. He's talking to a lot of the teachers of the law. But what has happened right before this scripture in Luke chapter 11, verse 28, at the beginning of Luke chapter 11, we see that Jesus does an incredible miracle, and he heals somebody who has a demon. He casts a demon out of them. Isn't it that awesome when God puts people back in their right minds again? Where you got your mess, and you're just crazy, and yet God gets a hold of you and sets you free? Beautiful thing, isn't it? Well, that's what Jesus just did for someone. And everybody saw it happen, and there's all this hype, and all these people are gathering around Jesus. And a lot of different people come to see the sign, to see what's going on. And the people that show up late say, hey, Jesus, if you're really who you say you are, do another sign. So you have this group of hecklers say, Jesus, do more miracles, right? And then you have a group of Pharisees, a bunch of religious leaders that come up to Jesus, and they basically say, oh, don't believe him. Jesus is filled with Satan. That's why he can do these miracles, right? So you have these people that are seeking, you have these people that are skeptics, and then you have another group of people that believe in Jesus. And a lady right before the scripture we read said, blessed is the mother who gave you birth and nursed you, you know, and said, just they think Jesus is awesome. So you have skeptics, you have seekers, you have people that are sincere, they don't know the whole story, right? And here's Jesus with all these people around him. And then it says in verse 29, as the crowds increased, Jesus said, this is a wicked generation. It asks for a miraculous sign, but none will be given it except the sign of Jonah. And here we are kind of at the beginning of our story. So think about it. Jesus has a whole bunch of people around him. He's got seekers. He's got skeptics. He's got people that are sincere. And he does something that's very, very politically incorrect. The first thing he does is he insults his audience. He says, this is a wicked generation. This is a wicked generation. Man, Jesus isn't a people pleaser, is he? He tells you what you need to hear, not what you want to hear. Isn't that awesome about our God? But guys, you know we're living in a wicked generation right now, right? In a lot of different ways. And we can see it. We can see that people are getting torn more and more toward immorality. You look at what's happening across the world with ISIS and the way that they're murdering people. The terrorist attacks, the one that happened in Manchester not long ago. We're living in a wicked generation, right? And Jesus says to this generation, you guys are a wicked generation. And this is the first statement in this story that I think Jesus said, and everybody said, that's not true. That's false. We're not a wicked generation. And I think they had a right to say that. And here's why. Yes, it is true that you had the Roman people, right? The Romans who were oppressing them. And they were doing horrible, horrible things to people, crucifying people on crosses, murdering people, right? They were pretty wicked. You also had people like tax collectors, people that basically betrayed their own country so they could rob their friends and their families. You had people like we do today, people that were having adulterous relationships. Jesus confronted some of those people, right? People that weren't doing things God's way. So you did have some wicked generation there. But the people that Jesus is actually specifically talking to right now aren't necessarily the people that you would think he would call a wicked generation. Because who he's talking to aren't the outcasts and people that are doing all the bad stuff, but he's talking to people that look like they're seeking God. He's talking to the religious leaders. He's talking to Jews who are coming into the feast to worship God, right? These people look like they're doing some of the right things. And Jesus says, you guys are a wicked generation. Wow. And this seems to be so false, because even if you look at the history of the Bible, it looks like people at this time period are meticulously seeking to obey the law more than other people were. They were so meticulously trying to obey the law that they had a number of steps that they were allowed to take on the Sabbath day. And they would honor that, right? You know, they would tithe, and they wouldn't just tithe their money, but all of their, you know, spices and all of their little things and their pennies, basically. They would make sure they tithe to the very, very cent, right? They were very meticulous about the law, and the religious leaders were. And yet Jesus says, you guys are a wicked generation. That appears to be false, but it's very true. And the reason it's true is because, and this is the first truth statement that I see in this, is that even though man looks at the outward appearance, God looks at the heart. Amen?
Amen?
Even though man looks at the outward righteousness, God looks at our heart and looks at our motives. Let me give you some examples. Let me ask you this question, actually. Think about this. What's more wicked? Is it more wicked to be a drunk, to be a drug addict, to be a thief, to be somebody that's, you know, living immorally out of a relation, you know, something like that. You know what I'm saying? Or is it more wicked to be a lawyer who knows this person actually did speed, but somehow is able to change it to a non-moving violation using the law, doing it legally, but saying it's something that's not, getting away with it? Is it more wicked to be a judge who puts people in prison because they raped somebody or did something horrible like that, but goes home and looks at a pornographic magazine. It's legal. But what's, is it wicked? Is it right? Is it more wicked to be a preacher who preaches to get more people to come to church so he can preach the kind of messages so they'll be happy, so they'll give more money, so he can have the kind of lifestyle he wants to have, make the money he needs to? Is it more wicked to be a Christian who says they love God, but secretly, when no one's around, he goes out, clicks on the TV set, watches things he knows he shouldn't, but he's like, yeah, nobody knows, it's not hurting anybody. Guys, man looks on the outward appearance, but God looks at the heart. Let me give you an example of somebody I know. I have a friend back in Missouri, a guy that I talked with. He was just a really cool guy. He had four daughters. They were a really neat Christian family. I was talking to him and asked him what kind of work he did. He said, oh, I'm a software designer. And he started telling me about his software. This guy actually was one of the first people to come up with the software. Let me try to explain this. Have you ever seen like a baseball game and you notice they got the green screen kind of behind the plate, right? And you have different advertisements that will come up at different points. Do you realize that when you're looking at those advertisements, sometimes you see ones that are local to you? This guy came up with the software that basically every different network can put whatever advertisement on those billboards in the live game while it's happening. And he made that, and they did it, and the first people to do it with the World Cup and doing this, and it was awesome. They were making lots of money. He designed this. And he told me how their company was doing so good. It was two or three guys that started this company. And they needed some more money so they could get their company to go bigger. So they found this investor who came in, who poured a couple million dollars into their business. And he said, but I have to have a controlling share in it. And they're like, okay, yeah. So then 2009 came along or so when the economy started to tank. And everybody started losing money. And then that guy was like, oh, no, we can't invest money. Let's pull all our money out of it. I'm sorry, if you're going to keep working here, you're going to have to work for free. And so they had to do it. And so they started taking out all their savings and pouring it in so they could keep working. And they did this for 6 months until their savings was depleted. And they had to mortgage their homes. And then the guy said, I'm sorry, it's just not working. We're going to have to shut down the business. And so he shuts down the company. And then in the same week, this guy, because he was a big businessman, created another company of his own and bought that company when it was worthless, and then went and hired everybody back and paid them just a little bit. And talk about feeling broken. These guys, my friend, they had poured their life into this business. And eventually one of them quit, and the guy who owned the company now was like, what did he quit for? What's going on? And my friend said, well, you kind of robbed all of us and stole us and kind of ruined our careers and made us, you know, mortgage our homes. He's like, I didn't do anything wrong. I did nothing that was illegal. And that was his logic. He's like, I'm honoring the law. But his heart was to rip everybody off. Guys, man looks on the outward appearance, but God looks at the heart. Guys, I want to ask you a question in your own hearts. Are you still looking okay? But deep down in heart, are you still living in sin? You know what Jesus called people like that? He called them whitewashed tombs. The outward, they look good, but inside, they're full of dead man's bones. And that's the truth here. Yes, it was a wicked generation. It might have looked like a good generation to everyone, but he knew that their hearts were for themselves and not for the things of God. So let's continue on. So the second thing, in the same verse, again in verse 29, it says, as the crowds increased, Jesus said, this is a wicked generation. It asked for a miraculous sign, but none will be given it except the sign of Jonah. The second statement that Jesus says that appears to be false here is Jesus says, I'm not going to give you any signs except for just one. Jesus says, I'm not going to give you any sign except for one. Now that looks like it's false. It does to me because Jesus just did a sign, right? He just cast a demon out of somebody. At this point, Jesus has raised people from the dead. Jesus has healed people. And you know what? Jesus is going to do a lot more miracles still. In the Gospels, we see 37 different miracles, different signs that Jesus showed to prove he was God, basically. Jesus did a lot more than one, didn't he? That appears to be false. But the reality is it's very true because even though he did many miracles, there was only one miracle that was for that wicked generation, one miracle that would pertain specifically to them that they had to recognize, had to realize was from him. And that miracle was that he was going to raise from the dead. And just kind of look here again. I've never preached this before, so I'm going to look at my notes here. And the truth in this that I see is that supernatural signs do not satisfy stiff-neckedness, if that's a word. Is that supernatural signs aren't going to make us believe. Jesus could give us lots and lots of miracles, but it doesn't mean we're going to turn our hearts. We're going to soften our hearts, right? Let me give some examples in the Bible of that. You guys ever heard of Moses? Moses did a lot of miracles, right? Did the Israelites turn out to be great God-fearing people all the time? No, they turned their backs over and over and over again. Guys, there's a guy named Jeroboam. God sent a prophet to him that gave him four miracles in one day. He didn't turn his heart to God. He went stiff-necked into his idol worship. You had Elijah. God gave lots of signs for him. People there, they continue to reject God. Even when you get to Revelations, it says God's going to do all these miracles. He's going to cause one-third of the ocean to turn into blood. He's going to do all these things. He's going to rain down hail and fire. And it says the people will not turn their hearts toward God. They're still going to shake their fists at him and not believe in him, even after they see all this stuff. And that's the reality. We might think, oh, God, if you would just do this miracle right now, I'm going to believe in you. It doesn't work like that. God's tried that before over and over and over again, and we continue to reject him. And that's the reality, is supernatural signs, giving us lots of them, isn't what satisfies us. What satisfies us is coming to a place where we surrender our hearts. Amen? In my own life, I have a little brother. I've seen so many miracles in my life. I have a little brother seen all the same things I have. Yet he's living apart from God. You guys might know people like that. Where God showed them grace and mercy, and they still reject him. God shows us so many signs every day. Whether it's creation, whether it's just mercy we don't deserve. But until we come to a place where we surrender our hearts, we're not going to be free. So let's continue on. The third statement that Jesus says that looks like it's false, but it's actually true, is that he says, but none will be given except for the sign of Jonah. So no sign is going to be given that you have to deal with that pertains to you except for the sign of Jonah. Now, you guys know what the sign of Jonah is? That's good, because the guys back here didn't know it either. What's interesting about this and why this appears to be false is that Jonah never gives any signs. It's interesting Jesus says this. You know, lots of the prophets in the Old Testament gave signs. Again, Elijah gave lots of signs. Moses gave lots of signs. But Jonah's one of the prophets that never did any miraculous sign at all. So what's Jesus talking about here when he says, none will be given except the sign of Jonah? Well, there's two different ways to understand that. Number one, Jonah. What happened to Jonah? Anybody remember the story of us? What did he get eaten by?
A whale
or a big fish, right? And how long was he in the whale?
3 days.
3 days, three nights, right? And then he came out and he was alive, right? Well, that, in one sense, obviously pertains to Jesus. In Matthew, it says that specifically pertains to him. Jesus, part of his sign was he was in the heart of the earth. He was buried for 3 days, right? And then he came back to life. So that's similar to Jesus. That's part of that sign. But the cool thing, what I think the sign of Jonah is, isn't something that Jonah did, but who Jonah was. And give me a minute, hang with me on this to try to explain this. Imagine that a person or an animal, anything, gets eaten by a big fish or a whale, okay? Something big enough. And imagine by some miracle that person survived. And it's sitting in digestive fluid for 3 days. In the dark, with no light, barely enough air to get by. And then that animal vomits that person back on the shore. Now, you guys might have seen what your cat hacked up at some point, right? Can you imagine what that person may have looked like? The possibility that maybe they were maybe just a little bit mutilated. They looked a little different than they did before. Have you ever wondered why it is when Jonah goes back to the people of Nineveh, who are a pagan people, who don't have any respect for God or the Israelites, and he shows up and he shares this message that God's going to destroy this city in a few days, fact that they all get it, they all listen to him? Maybe it was because he didn't look like anybody they'd ever seen before. Maybe he had the marks of his rebellion and disobedience all over him. And that woke them up and got their attention. Like, oh my gosh, if God would do this to one of his own people that rebelled against him, what is he going to do for us? Maybe he's for real. Ever thought about that? And the truth that I see with this is that God can use the marks of our sin and the marks of our rebellion to draw other people to him. Amen?
Amen.
God can use the marks of our rebellion and our sin to draw people to him. I have a friend, again, I have lots of friends across the country. I have a friend in Louisiana, a guy I know. And I love him, and he's on fire for God now. But he's hard for me to look straight in the eyes, I'll be honest, because when he was in his sin, when he was in the world and doing the things he shouldn't, he got into some trouble and messed with somebody, and they hurt him really bad, and he lost his nose. And you look at him, there's just two holes in his face. And he goes and he speaks at youth conferences, and you know what? Those youth always look right at him because they realize, whoa, what happened to this guy? And I want to tell you, just even for me personally, just seeing him, as much as I love him and I try to see past it, his life, just who he is a big jolt and reminder to me, I don't need to go down that road. I don't need to continue that way. I've talked about this in another message, but God can use us no matter who we are. We can be an example of his mercy and his grace, or God can use us as an example of his justice. What kind of example will you be? God can use the marks of sin as a sign to other people. I'll give you another one. Sin, even when it hurts other people, it still wakes people up. This is a hard example to talk about. I know of a woman I heard on the radio about a year ago. And while they were on the radio, they said, hey, we're going to give you the description of what this girl looks like. And it was horrible. I was, oh my gosh, there's... But you were talking about how her face was kind of deformed and how her hair was not growing in right. And given all these examples, and this girl happened to be an abortion survivor. That somebody tried to do a chemical abortion on this girl. And then she was born, but she lived through it somehow. And she said, the reason I'm on the radio and the reason I go on TV and share my testimony is because I want people to see what sin does to people. That's wrong, and how it really hurts living people. And God, it's horrible that happened. I don't think God ever, ever intended that to happen. But sometimes those visual appearances are a wake-up call to draw us away from our sin. God can use even the marks of sin as a sign to others. So let's continue on this story. Now we're just going to read the scripture for a minute. In verse 30 through 32, and it says, for as Jonah was assigned to the Ninevites, so also was the Son of Man, will the Son of Man be to this generation. The Queen of the South will rise at the judgment with the men of this generation and condemn them. For she came from the ends of the earth to listen to Solomon's wisdom. And now one greater than Solomon is here. The men of Nineveh will stand up at the judgment with this generation and condemn it. For they repented at the preaching of Jonah. And now one greater than Jonah is here. And so in the scripture here, we see the fourth statement that Jesus says that to the people around them, they would have thought, this can't be true. This has to be false. And we find it in two ways, because it says, number one, that the Ninevites who repented of their sin and came to God, that they're going to rise at the last days. And a woman called the Queen of the South, or the Queen of Sheba, if you've ever heard of her, a woman who went and saw Solomon, she's going to rise in the last days. And that these two people that were outsiders, that were not Jews, that their people didn't originally have anything to do as being the children of God, that they're going to have eternal life. And they're actually going to be more righteous. They're going to condemn the people that are faking it. And what's interesting in both of those stories, when you talk about the Ninevites, is that those Ninevites turned away from their false gods. They turned away from their sins, and they glorified God. The same thing with the Queen of Sheba. If you read the story in Solomon, it says that she praises Solomon, but primarily she praises the Lord. She says, look what God has done. To God be the glory for the way he's blessed you and the wisdom he's given you. I didn't believe that God could do that, but now I believe because I see what he's done in you. Those two outcasts, people that had no part of God, were drawn in, and they are going to live in the last days. They're going to have eternal life, and they're going to experience grace. Praise God.
Praise God.
And that's the fourth truth that I see with this, is that it's not the outwardly righteous, but the repentive outsiders that receive grace. Amen?
Amen.
It's not those who are outwardly righteous, but those that are repentive, even if they're outsiders, that receive grace. You might think, well, I grew up in some mess. I'm not ever going to get there, you know. If you're repentant, God gives you grace. God's going to let you experience eternal life. Amen? Life better than you've ever experienced here before.
Amen?
Amen? Guys, and I want to talk, just so we get this, explain what true repentance is. Repentance isn't just saying, God, I'm really sorry for what I did wrong. But what repentance is when you see your life still in one direction and you make the decision, I'm not going after this. I'm turning around, and now I'm going after God as best as I can. It's not a decision that now you're instantly perfect, but it's saying that you're going a completely different direction. You're getting closer, and you're getting more like Jesus every day. Amen?
Amen?
And if you stumble, you get up, and you keep going that direction. That's what repentance is. And it wraps all up with the final point, which is the first point that Jesus said, blessed rather are those who hear the word of God and obey it. Doesn't matter what you look like, what you act like, who you think you are. It's about your heart. And so just to wrap up all those points for you again, do my best to explain it. The first false thing that was actually true, the first thing that the people thought was false was that Jesus called them a wicked generation. And the truth is that God looks at the heart. Again, I want to challenge this. Let's look at our hearts. Are we doing things for look and appearance? Things we think are legal and okay? Are we really setting our heart after Christ? Second thing, Jesus said there was going to be no more miraculous signs when he was showing lots of signs. And the point to that was that if Jesus shows a zillion signs, it doesn't make a difference if we're stiff-necked, if our hearts are hard. The only thing that'll save us is surrender to his grace. Third thing was the sign of Jonah and what that means. And I believe the sign of Jonah wasn't a sign he did, but it was who he was. And for us, I believe the truth is that even the marks of sin can shout out to others. Fourth and final thing is that the judgment says the Ninevites and the Queen of Sheba are going to rise. They're going to experience grace and eternal life, even though they were outcasts and outsiders. And the point is, it's not the outwardly righteous, but the repentant outsiders that will experience grace. So let's just pray. Thank you for listening today. And let's just surrender ourselves to repent and seek wholeheartedly after our God. Father God, we love you so much. I thank you for your word, for how rich it is, God. And God, I just pray that the truth of your word got across, Lord. God, I pray that you would just burden our hearts, God, not to go through the motions, not just to do things for appearance, God, but God, refine our heart. Take out that stony heart, God, and place in us a new heart, God. And help us to have the resolve to let go of who we were and be who we were meant to be in you by following after you day by day. And we just give you the praise in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
God bless you all.
Thank you.
Thank you.